written what is kind of introduction, and also thank you so much for having invited me, and also for this magnificent preparation that I noticed characterizes this meeting. And it's not always like that. Forget about this beautiful aula here, which is something that my university would be proud of to have, but many other things I experienced in the short time I have been here, and so thank you for making it possible for me to be here. Now, my talk is about basically grammaticalization, which will also be briefly discussed in the first part of my talk. Then in the second part, I will deal with, from the perspective of a student of grammaticalization, with the relation between compounding and derivation. And then come to a more hairy topic, namely that between derivation and inflection. And finally, some brief conclusions after all. So this is the program. And let's move then to the first part. And as Professor Renner said, my main area of specialization is African languages, where I've spent quite some time doing research, at least for the last 15 years or so, and I've been living in Africa for a long time, so it's my big love and also the center of my academic life. Here is a set of data from a fairly exotic African languages, namely Kum, which is a language spoken in southern Africa. I will tell you more about this language a little bit later. For the moment, let's just look at the data here, and especially at one item which is printed in bold, namely Mhe, which occurs in a number of different uses in this language. So in A you see that Mhe has the meaning of a full-fledged noun meaning children. Then in B the same element serves as the head of a modifying compound. So Kromhe means a child of an elephant or elephant calf. Now in C you have the same element in a different function and different morphosyntactic environment where it means combined with things like now house, it means a small thing, that is a small house. And finally, in a D, you find the same element being used exclusively in the function of a plural marker, and so it has features of an inflectional suffix. So, this fact now is in need of explanation, as I think. And the kinds of explanations you might be looking at is, first, there is no explanation, just accept it, this is the way it is. The second possibility is to say, well, there are some synchronic explanations which within the structure of the language, for example, which help you to account for this co-occurrence pattern. And the third explanation is a diachronic explanation. That is, explanation in terms of the history of the language, or languages involved. And I will be restricted here to C, that is, to diachronic explanation. And in doing so, I will be restricted to the paradigm of grammaticalization theory. And now, in cases of languages like this, Kun, or most of the other African languages, we don't have any written historical documents. So the question is, are we in a position to reconstruct earlier states of the language? This has been a big issue in the 1990s and in the early part of the present millennium, but it seems that the problem is largely solved in that we are in a position to reconstruct earlier states of a language by using linguistic methodology. And this methodology has the four main components. One is the comparative method, which you all know is a well-established method, which at least gives you a little bit of access to earlier states also, not only of sounds or phonemes, but also of morphological and even syntactic pattern. Then we have the very well established field of internal reconstruction. And finally, then we have typological generalizations, that is, looking at different languages and extrapolating from the known to the unknown typologically. And finally, now this is a grammaticalization which has been used for the last 30 years now in order to reconstruct earlier states of languages, including languages where we have little or no historical records. Now, there are about 50 different definitions of grammaticalization, but most of them converge, that the present definition by Jerzy Kurewicz is still the one that most of us in some way or other would subscribe to, which means that grammaticalization is understood or as a decrease of the range of a morpheme advancing from lexical to grammatical or from a less grammatical to a more grammatical status, for example, from the derivative formal to inflectional one, unquote. Nowadays, as you know, a construction grammar is a fairly new field of studies for good reasons, so. Construction grammarians might argue that instead of formants, you could replace it by constructions. I have problems with that. I cannot go into that, but if you have questions on that, we can do that in the discussion after the talk. Okay, so many definitions, but there is a common core to most of these definitions. Arguing that there is a widespread developmental pattern, for example, leading from lexical structures to derivational structures and finally to inflectional structure. Now, as most of you will probably also be aware, is that the distinction between lexical and grammar has become the subject of critical opinions. And I didn't hear one particularly pronounced position, namely by Hünig and Boyd, which says it is especially the dichotomy of the lexical versus the grammatical that turns out to be inadequate for a proper account of word formation phenomena. Now, I'm not entirely sure whether this position can be maintained. Actually, our group has written a paper to show that this claim is in need of reconsideration. The paper is the one mentioned here below. where we say in more detail that the distinction has a place, but again, this is something which we will take up in the discussion. Now, underlying this grammaticalization phenomenon, there is a unidirectionality principle, which holds true for most of grammatical changes. There are very few exceptions to this principle. So exceptions that have been discussed under labels such as degrammaticalization and the standard work, but there are many other papers and written about that. Is by Miriam Dorgel on the grammaticalization, where you find a fairly balanced of all the views that have been presented on this issue. So there are documented cases of reversal of unidirectionality, but they are statistically fairly rare, and furthermore, certain processes. For such processes, we have so far no evidence of any reversal. So take, for example, the paradigm development from lexical items to adpositions, prepositions or postpositions, and finally to case markers, such as case inflection. Now, I know of no language where it has happened that a reversal of this process leading from case inflections to adpositions and lexical items has been documented. So there are a few general findings that suggest that the unidirectionality principle stands on a fairly solid ground. So if you want quite a solid discussion of this issue, here is the one by Kerstin Nurias and Vincent giving you more information about that. Now, this slide shows you the main lines of grammatical development that have been recorded so far, at least from one perspective, maybe from the perspective of more morphological types. So the typical development goes from noun, possibly to verbs, but this is something that is not entirely well established, but from nouns to adjectives or adverbs, and from there towards demonstratives, adpositions, aspect markers, and negation markers, that is from verbs normally. And then demonstratives are a rich source for all kinds of grammatical forms, such as personal pronouns, definite markers, relative clause markers, complementizers, and so on. And case markers, tense markers, and a number of other things are on this stage now. And finally, at layer 6 here, Roman 6, there are grammatical elements that are the most grammaticalized, as we say, typically, but not only in inflectional stuff that marks the final stage of grammaticalization before something may disappear as a distinct grammatical expression. So these are some of the main lines that have been identified, but this all takes care of only a small spectrum and only of one perspective of the phenomenon looked at. Now, the parameters of grammaticalization, how do we discover what grammaticalization is? Now, there are a number of different criteria that have been proposed. we our framework use four main criteria. Namely, one called extension, or context is extension, according to which list linguistic expressions are extended to new context that invite the rise of grammatical functions. Then there is desemanticization, that is loss of meaning content, or generalization, as John Biney would have it, generalization of the existing meaning, which becomes more general. And third, there is decategorialization, that is a loss of properties that characterize the element concerned. For example, a noun losing categorical properties such as age marking, gender marking, plural marking, number marking, and so on. And finally, there is erosion or phonetic reduction. That is, in the course of the process, there tends to be a loss of phonetic material, including suprasegmental prosodic material. Now, erosion is something that usually comes in at a late stage in the grammaticalization of an item, and in many cases, it has so far not taken place. So erosion is not a parameter that one should use in order to identify instances of grammaticalization. Now, my concern will be, as I mentioned, the development from compounding to derivation and from derivation to flexural affixes. So I will have nothing to say about the first stage, leading from free combining, like possessive, nominal possessive constructions, to compounding. This is an issue where you find at least a little bit of information in the paper by Elizabeth Chauber and Brian Charles, which is mentioned here. With regard to compounding, I'll be restricted to right-headed modifying or endocentric compounds having two constituents, where one of the constituents is the modifier and the other the head. And I will also be restricted to African languages. Now, things that you know much better than I do, I am not a morphologist, so I just want to pinpoint what I am after, compounding and derivation beyond word formation. Compounding involves typically the formation of a new lexeme by joining two or more lexemes. Whereas derivation, well, difficult to define, I'm just for the purposes of this paper using this negative definition in order to deal with derivation. Now, the morphological status of derivation has been discussed controversially. From a grammaticalization perspective, derivational forms are grammatical items, and accordingly they differ from lexical compounding type items in firstly that they are discursively secondary rather than discursively primary. Second, they express schematic, not rich semantic content, but rather one of several schematic functions. And third, they are closed class items. That is, they belong to paradigms that are in some way restricted compared to lexical items. And fourth, they are typical affixes or clitics rather than free forms. And most importantly, from our perspective, is that they can, as a rule, be derived historically from lexical items by means of canonical parameters of grammaticalization, such as the one that I mentioned. Okay, now looking at some common processes that have been identified in the study of African languages by using the four parameters I mentioned. First, context, text extension. You have a head noun which is extended by different kinds of constituents, productively in some way, then the result is that the head noun, that is C2 of the compound, the second conjunct, loses part or all of its lexical meaning, gradually acquiring a grammatical function. Then comes in decategorialization, in that the head noun loses morphosyntactic properties characteristic of its lexical category and will gradually develop in the direction of an affix. And furthermore than the erosion, the head noun will is likely to lose some of its phonological properties in the course of this development. Now the brief example from three African languages. The first is from Ik, a language spoken by something like 5,000 people in northeastern Uganda, belonging to the Nilo-Saharan language family. The second is from Ewe, spoken in Ghana and Togo of West Africa. And the third is from the language I was dealing with already, namely Ku, which belongs to the so-called KOŠICE language family in South Africa. So we carried out a quantitative survey of 99 African languages, and according to this survey, nouns for child are used productively as derivational forms in roughly half of the languages in some way or other to express a diminutive meaning. This is something now that is typically African. It is occasionally found in other parts of the world, but in Africa this is a very widespread process. So, let's have a look at examples from the three languages I mentioned. In the Ik language, you find the noun ima, which is also used as a diminutive suffix, like in ofolma, good child is a small boy, as a diminutive. Similarly, in Ewe of West Africa, there is a noun Ivi, meaning child, and which is similar to the diminutive suffix Ivi, like in Kwili, literally stone child, which is a small stone. And finally, in the third language I mentioned, we have a noun Ma, meaning child of somebody, that is a relation noun, and also a corresponding diminutive suffix ma, like in the example we have already, a small house or a hut. Good, so this is a fairly widespread process, and I will now narrow down the subject to the last language here, namely to Kung, and try try to say in some more details what I found out on this issue in this language. These are for children that used to come to our research camp, and so they were our daily visitors, and neatly separated by a fence from us so that they would not molest us in our camp. But they were absolutely sweet, and we had a nice exchange in the course of our research. Now, Ku is a traditional hunter-gatherer language spoken by about 15,000 people in southern Africa, in three different countries, southern Angola, northern and eastern Namibia, and western Botswana. And it belongs to the Ka family, formally classified as a KOŠICE language. It is a typically a language of hunter-gatherers, so some of you may have seen a movie entitled The Gods Must Be Crazy with a Coca-Cola bottle. Now these are the people I'm talking about here. Okay, typological features of the language are it's a highly context-dependent language showing fairly analytic isolating morphology. The basic order is SVO, but there is also a modifier head construction in the nominal possession. Then the language has a noun class system with four noun classes. Now some of you may be familiar with noun classes of Bantu languages. This is a completely different story, and the noun classes are very different from that, but that is a topic that we don't concern us here. Then, phonological features are, it is a tone language having four distinct levels of tone, and it has five click types. So these are the ones listed here. The alveolar, which you have heard already repeatedly, okay, like in Kum, is a one of the five types that you find in the language. Not only in this language, but also in all the other KOŠICE languages. Okay, now in this language, there are three main types of number marking of nouns. The first is don't mark number in any way. So if you say gun, meaning a tree or trees, there is no number distinction. You have a possibility via the agreement system to specify number of nouns, but this is not normally done. So most of the nouns, more than 90% of the nouns, don't mark number. Then the second one is suppletion. So using a different stem for singular and plural. Like in this example here, so the word for footprint is in the singular, mhura, and in the plural, shua. Completely different stems. And the third way of doing it is by taking the plural suffix mhe, which some of you might remember that we had that earlier, but I will come back to that. So let's look at that in more detail. We can reconstruct the development in Ku from lexical nouns to a compounding in the following way. In that stage one, you are dealing with nouns like the noun mine, my children, mine being a fully lexical item. Now at stage two, the head noun he is attached to animals, human beings or animals. And the meaning then is the young one or a child of the animal concerned, like a colony, elephant. ever met an elephant calf. And at stage three, you find cases like noun he, where he is attached to inanimate nouns. And now, all of a sudden, you have a fairly clear and irrational functioning that of a diminutive. Now, Ko is fairly poor in morphology, in derivational and inflectional morphology. The main derivational suffixes that are used in the language are these ones. First, the one that you just had, the diminutive. Second, there is a suffix meaning bane, apparently derived from a noun plural, nai, men. The third is a suffix meaning female, derived apparently from a noun de, from mother. And the fourth one is a noun used when added to verbs as a default agent noun. So derived apparently from the noun cow as the owner. So we can reconstruct the pattern leading from three nominal elements to derivational ones, a process that at a crucial stage is that the head noun here, a children, was applied to inanimate concepts. But Ko also seems to show the state, the development into an inflectional item in accordance with the definition by Koren, which I mentioned at the beginning. Now, I said nouns are essentially transneural, that is, they don't mark number, but we have these subheated nouns that use a different lexical item to distinguish number. And now, with some of these nouns, one of these nouns is the noun ma-ma-chai, plural me. And now, this can be used productively, or can be used productively with any noun as a diminutive. So, it's fully productive derivational element. But with some nouns, it has become lexicalized. That is, the suffix ma plural me was frozen and became a frozen part. For example, with the noun chama plural chame, old man, there is only there is no simple ha, as you can see here. So here are a few examples showing you now all the stages of development. At stage 0, the lexical state. At stage 1, the extension to animate concepts. At stage 2, extension to inanimate context. And stage 3, now this is new. The element is attached to or is generalized and gradually merges with the preceding noun to form a new univerbal element. So we have in stage 3 a noun like kama, plural kame, animal, that's the word for animal, which is must be historically related to a combination ka meaning meat and me meaning children. And at the final stage there is nothing more of a simple noun phrase that could be interpreted as being a derived from a lexical item, namely the noun for hama, means old man, and plural is hame, old men, where the me now serves exclusively as a number, and therefore simply ha, the animal in the language. But there is a small number of nouns behaving in this way, namely the one just mentioned, hama, or plural hame, then uima, which stands for a character or a lynx, a kind of a smaller predator, and the word for woman. Now, dama, woman, about dame, women. Where there is no more symbols than da or de in the language, and mhe is only plural marking and its function. Why there is this phonological irregularity is something that we have been able to reconstruct so far. So the transition from derivation to inflection in mhe appears in some sense to be unusual due to the reinterpretation of the lexical distinction of the grammatical, that is the affix of distinction. But nevertheless, even that developing into inflection shows the clear signs of grammaticalization. For example, the semanticization, the derivational meaning of diminuity was lost, and what remained was the simple function of number marking of plural with this small group of noun. And decategorialization, the element turned from an optional into now an obligatory component of the lexical host, and the element lost its ability to form new words. So it is stuck frozen there as a suffix. But it seems that there are also features that are widely held to be associated with inflectional elements, but are absent in inflectional element mhe. Thus, from what I know about word formation, the little I know about word formation, inflectional affixes are more likely than derivational ones to form morphological paradigm. This has been emphasized by a number of authors. But whereas derivational mhe is a member of a paradigm of nominal suffix, a fully productive member, as I mentioned earlier, inflection here is not such that it is the only inflection nominal suffix of the language. Then the inflection affixes tend to be more productive than the derivational ones. Again, this doesn't apply in the present case, since here is productive, whereas inflection here is restricted to a few dozens of nouns in the language. And finally, inflectional affixes, unlike derivational ones, are said to be able to form pronominal morphemes of the Latin gender number case type pronouns. But this does not apply to inflectional mhe, which is restricted to one specific function, as I mentioned repeatedly, namely that of number marking. So, some properties distinguishing a derivation and inflectional mhe, as you can see here, I don't think I need to comment that there are some features that can be related, as it seems to be, to inflectional elements and other features that can be related to derivation elements. Uh, course, there is quite some controversy in the way of distinguishing between derivation and inflection. But it seems that, nevertheless, they are free to argue that such a boundary exists in the case examined, if it presents a few unusual features. So I think we can make a case for a distinction between inflection and derivation elements in this purely analytic, fairly purely analytic language. Now let me come to the conclusion. This is one of the old ladies who served as an informant for us, who is highly knowledgeable, more than most men, although men would not agree with this assessment. The observations that I made are on the whole compatible with the generalizations of the derivation that you find, for example, in Lieber and Schenkau. Mention may be made that Kuhl does not seem to have any productive patterns of word formation via reduplication. Now, this is fairly unusual for Africa, where reduplication is quite a common phenomenon, but because some languages seem to be an exception. But the main goal of the paper was to account for why one and the same linguistic form can be associated simultaneously with the status of a lexeme, a conjunct of a compound, a derivational, and an inflectional asset. And the development from compounding to derivation is quite regular and can be documented for every single African language, the languages, in a similar way. And also has the features that applies in the history of derivational processes as they can be reconstructed in European languages. But the development from derivation to inflection is something that is not a quite regular process of a grammaticalization, and where it can be found, it tends to have its own idiosyncratic features, and this also applies to Kuhl, where we have a frozen structure that is reinterpreted as an inflectional in the language. Now, obviously, as I mentioned, I'm not a morphologist, nor one that can claim any deeper knowledge of word formation processes. And what I said you have to see in this light. Furthermore, I was restricted to one particular continent of the world, although every third language of the world is in fact an African language. But nevertheless, it's only a part of the world's inventory of languages. And I was only restricted to one particular perspective, namely that of a student of grammaticalization. And it goes without saying that grammaticalization is very restricted in what it can contribute to processes of word formation. But at least it can shed light on a few features that some of you may have problems with, and I hope this has contributed a little bit to this end. So thank you very much.